In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Welcome to St. John's this morning for our worship, whether you're joining us here in the building or whether you're in the dry and enjoying it from there. It's good that we are united in our worship together. So we prepare our hearts and minds in the words of the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Spirit of the Lord fills the world and knows our every word and deed. So let us then open ourselves to the Lord and confess our sins in penitence and faith. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. May the God of love bring you back to himself, forgive you your sins, and assure you of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless till they find their rest in you. Pour your love into our hearts and draw us to yourself, and so bring us at last to your heavenly city, where we shall see you face to face. through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Do please be seated for our readings.
A reading from the Wisdom of Solomon. But the ungodly, by their words and deeds, summon death, considering him a friend. They pined away and made a covenant with him, because they are fit to belong to his company. For they reasoned unsoundly, saying to themselves, "Short and sorrowful is our life, and there is no remedy when a life comes to its end, and no one has been known to return from Hades. Let us lie in wait for the righteous man, because he is inconvenient to us and opposes our actions. He reproaches us for sins against the law and accuses us of sins against our training. He professes to have knowledge of God and calls himself a child of the Lord. He became to us a reproof of our thoughts. The very sight of him is a burden to us, because his manner of life is unlike that of others, and his ways are strange. We are considered by him as something base, and he avoids our ways as unclean. He calls the last end of the righteous happy, and boasts that God is his father. Let us see if his words are true, and let us test what will happen at the end of his life. For if the righteous man is God's child, he will help him and will deliver him from the hand of his adversaries. Let us test him with insult and torture, so that we may find out how gentle he is and make trial of his forbearance. Let us condemn him to a shameful death, for, according to what he says, he will be protected." Thus they reasoned, but they were led astray, for their wickedness blinded them, and they did not know the secret purposes of God, nor hoped for the wages of holiness, nor discerned the price for blameless souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from James. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have, because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive, because you ask wrongly, in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. This is the word of the Lord.
For our second hymn, number 356, I understand it's one that's not overly familiar here, so Stephen is going to play it through. Are we not picking up? Is that better? No? I think my battery may have gone. I'll step forward here. Hymn number 356, I understand, is not overly familiar to us here. So Stephen's going to play the verse through, and then we'll stand to sing. It's fairly regular, so we should be able to pick it up by the time we get to verse 4, hopefully. Thank you. May I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Do please be seated. I'd like you to think just for a moment, who have been the best teachers you have known? What was it that made them good teachers? What did they help you to learn? I remember a couple of teachers from my secondary school One, I recall, I think, for totally the wrong reason. There was always a scramble to get into his classroom before the lesson started. Not to be close to him, to catch every word that he was going to speak, not to be noticed as if we were going to be looking quite keen and wanting to be there, ready to learn. Actually, it was there to bag seats as far away from him as we could possibly get, and especially to avoid sitting at the tables right at the front. This teacher had a temper that struck fear into you. If you weren't paying complete attention, or if you said something daft, which was usually my forte, when you did, he would turn from the chalkboard, turn his face on those on the front tables, and scowl. And if you're on those front tables, you would physically shrink back as he turned round. To this day, I cannot remember a single thing that that teacher taught me. I just recall the temper. In the same school, there was also a geography teacher who I'll call Mrs. M. She could be stern, she could be a tough taskmistress, but she was also fair. If you were willing to engage and put in the work, she'd give you a chance. Hence, Oxbow Lakes. I can remember being fascinated by how Oxbow Lakes are formed in rivers, those U-shaped stretches of water created when a wide, kind of meandering part of a river gradually becomes cut off, making a freestanding body of water. I can always remember Oxbow Lakes. I was never going to be an A-grade geographer, but Mrs. M gave me the chance to do an O-level, which shows how old I am, and we were both pleased when I got a grade C. Mrs. M not only taught me facts, she gave me an idea of what was possible, of what I might learn. Not just geography, but some growth in self-knowledge and something in confidence. Of course, I'm only talking about one particular kind of teacher. You might recall people who have taught you important things beyond the classroom, a mentor of some kind, a sports coach, an older relative or younger relative, a writer, perhaps someone that you've never even and never will meet, but you learn something from them. Teachers come in all shapes and sizes and ages. In our gospel reading, Jesus is teaching his disciples, but not what they expected to hear. He's talking of betrayal, of death, and of rising again. And they're puzzled. They don't ask him any questions. Is that because they don't want to look like they don't get it? Or are they afraid that they do realize what Jesus is telling them and don't want to accept it? Whatever the reason, they're missing the point. Because on the road, they argue about status, who is the greatest. They have an important lesson to learn. So Jesus draws around them, around him, to teach. He sits down, the position of a Jewish teacher in those times. And he brings into play what we might think to be an unlikely fellow teacher to help him, a little child. Then the lowliest status person in any household. Jesus sets the child in the center of them, and the child, simply by being who he or she is, helps them learn a vital lesson about status and power. That in the kingdom of God, by welcoming the weak and helpless, we welcome Jesus. And we welcome God, the Father, who sent him. Where his disciples had become bound up in ideas about hierarchy, Jesus flips all that on its head. He brings into the center the unexpected one who teaches an important lesson. How often do we let a child teach us and potentially draw us closer to God? Rebecca Nye, who has researched and written widely on children's spirituality, said this: children may be the model for adult spiritual development rather than the reverse. A task for adult spiritual development may be to recapture the child's more inclusive and all-pervading sense of relation to the spiritual, which means for them it's normal, everyday, rather than dramatic. An example might help explain a bit more of what Rebecca is saying. I can think of a child who taught me just that. I'm going to call him Al. He was due to be page boy at a wedding that I was doing back down in Gloucester. On the wedding rehearsal night, as he had arrived very early, really early, with his grandmother. So we were waiting for the others to arrive, and Al asked me lots, and I mean lots, of questions. We were exploring the church, we were looking at the stained glass, we were looking at the font and what that was for, to the cross, even to a box in the wall where donations were put. Eventually, the rehearsal party arrived and we all took our places and began. A couple of days later, on the day of the wedding, as guests began arriving, so did Al, very smart in his new suit. I was busy making my final preparations and I needed to go into the hall and switch on some lights. And he asked, can I come and follow you? Can I come and watch you do that? I said, of course you can. As we walked towards the hall, he fell in step right beside me and, totally unbidden, said, thank you, God, for Jesus and Easter and Christmas. Amen. Happy, heartfelt thankfulness for core parts of our faith. Unhindered by whether they were the right words or whether it was appropriate to say them there and then, it was just natural for him to thank God for things that mattered. I'm not going to sentimentalize it, but Al taught me, all wrapped up in my busyness about the wedding, what was really, truly important. He taught me not facts, but wisdom. And he taught me humility, to take the time to listen to him. Humility and wisdom were things the disciples needed to learn. And that's what the author of the letter of James is trying to impart as well. Who is wise and understanding among you? He asks. In a church setting, is it the people with positions of power and influence in the church, perhaps clergy, wise and understanding, possibly not, perhaps the PCC, church wardens or other officers of the church? Isn't it for wisdom and maturity that they're in those very roles that they're serving? But this isn't what James is saying. He offers some markers, bits of evidence of God wisdom in the life of the people. And they include being gentle or humble, being pure, being peaceable, willing to yield, i.e. not having everything their own way all the time, full of mercy, without partiality or hypocrisy. I wonder, how do each one of us measure up alongside those markers that James lays down? They're not easy to live into, particularly in a society centered on self-gratification, bewitched by status, ambition, celebrity. I think I'll always remember Al's simple prayer of thankfulness to God. I discovered subsequently that he himself was facing quite severe problems with his health and in his family.
yet still he could pray with gratitude for what Jesus meant to him. Not every child, not every member of the clergy, not every child will offer us wisdom or teach us about humility. Nor am I putting children on a pedestal and saying everything they say is going to be wise. Get them to tell you a joke and you probably won't understand it. But sometimes, if we're listening, a little child will teach us something about our own attitudes and about God. Will we welcome that child and what they might teach us? It might just be one way in which we discover how God draws near to us. Amen. So may I invite you to stand as you're able, as we affirm our faith together in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the Father. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Do please be seated for our prayers. To the words, Lord, in your mercy, would you respond? Hear our prayer. In trust and in humility, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give grace to your church to be the servant of all. All who cross our threshold of this place, all with whom we have contact of whatever kinds during the weekdays. Help your faithful people to work together for the kingdom, seeking no personal honour or reward. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Have mercy on the world, where so many are driven on by the desire for power and privilege. We continue to pray for Israel and Gaza, Ukraine and its conflict with Russia, and all those places in our world of hatred, division and violence. Lord, break through the pride which exalts nation against nation, race against race, class against class, and restore the innocence that we have lost. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the children in our families, for the children in our community, those who teach them and care for them. Protect them from harm and lead them into the future that is your will for each one of them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, have mercy on the victims of jealous power and all who are persecuted for the sake of the gospel. For our sisters and brothers who have been forced to flee lands where the faith has been practiced for many, many generations to find safety and security. Comfort and restore all who are afflicted in mind or body. And today we think especially of Betty Bourne, Enid King, Cess Taylor, John and Christine, Claire and Andrew, Josie, Barry, Russell, Joy, Bobby, Ian, Anthony, Amy, Robert, Rachel, Ella May, and Cyril Burton, and those who have been recently bereaved, thinking especially at this time of Angie Burrows and the family of Ron Cheetle. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who have passed through the trials and temptations of this world and are at rest. For Anna Maria Pearson, Colin Hall, Peter Booth, Beatrice Booth, and Albert Collett. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. May they rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen. Lord, receive all mercifully into your kingdom, where none ranks before another, but all rejoice in one equal glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. So may our prayers be accepted through Christ, who was betrayed and died that we might live. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
So may you like to stand as you are able for the peace. The risen Christ came, stood amongst his disciples, and said, "Peace be with you." And they were glad when they saw the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
With you.
One another, a sign of Christ's peace. Pray, my sisters and brothers, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at my hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for the good of all his church. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. You are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. So, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, And we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. John the Divine, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. So let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Christ our God to earth descended, of your image to the heaven. King of kings, yet born of Mary, as old on earth he is Lord. In the body and the blood, he will give to all the faithful his own self for heavenly food. Rank on rank the host of heaven spreads its wings.
And let us pray. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us and make us continually to be given to all good works through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. I have some notices to give.
As per usual, everything is on the blue sheet, but today is special. One of the best messages I've ever had to deliver. Next Sunday is bacon sandwiches. And I've talked to somebody, there will be tomatoes and sausages. And really, that's one of the most important things
today.
Yeah. Now, you all know. Next. The YMCA would like some bacon sandwiches as well, by the look of this. They urgently need food. And next Saturday morning is the coffee and cake morning. So they would like, if possible, for you to bring donations for the YMCA. And also, bingo and raffle and tombola in the Red Lion on Wednesday, the 2nd of October. This is for church funds. There are raffle tickets for sale. Sandra and Debbie have got them. Please support this. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Neville. Neville's over the great news of bacon next Sunday morning as we celebrate harvest. I won't be here to have that because I'll be shooting off back down to St. Paul's. So it's good news for most people, I think, Neville, not for everyone. Our prayer of blessing. The Lord be with you. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Mass is ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.